to ask about the Fresh Start Initiative. It's a special IRS tax debt assistance program
Are you a survivor of sexual abuse while in the Boy Scouts? You may be entitled to compensation, no matter how long. While in the Boy Scouts, your time to file a claim is limited, no matter how long. Call 800-717-8898. Your time to file a claim is limited. Call 800-717-8898 for more information. As a result of thousands of victims filing sexual abuse claims, for more information, the Boy Scouts have filed for bankruptcy protection. As a result of thousands of victims filing sexual abuse claims, has set November 16, 2020 as the deadline for abuse survivors to file a claim. November 16, 2020 as the deadline for abuse survivors to file a claim. You may be entitled to compensation, no matter how long ago in the Boy Scouts. You may be entitled to compensation with one of our compassionate counselors today. Happened. Your call is call completely for more anonymous with one remember, of our compassionate the bankruptcy counselors court today. Has set November 16, 2020 anonymous as the deadline remember, for abuse survivors to file a claim. Call 800-717 as the deadline for abuse survivors to file a claim. Call 800-717 today. 8898. Sponsored by Napoli Shkolman.
The opinions of the host on KDWN are their own
sponsored
and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of the host on KDWN or Beasley Media Group. And do not necessarily reflect the views of this station, its management, or Beasley Media Group.
Welcome to the Dr. Guy's Time. I'm RJ Bell. Welcome to the Dr. Guy's Time. The Day Before I Died. And Joe Whitaker will be joining us. Welcome to the show, Joe. Thank you. We need to talk about, and that is the Red Cross.
If you need to give blood or you can give blood, you can go to redcross.org.
And the other thing I want to mention today before we get started is that have joined Channel 13 over 100 degrees. They would put $100 in a pot. They would give that to charity. And this Friday we'll be on Channel 13, one of those businesses giving money to. So we will pick up that check on Friday, and one of those businesses giving money to.
So that was Silver State Refrigeration, they're great guys. They really help us out. We're still going to be triple digits for a while, but as we go to change and weather, you probably want to get that heater looked at before the winter, and you can give them a call.
899-3388.
And they are just one of the many sponsors we have that sponsor this show. And if you're watching on Facebook or the BTRC.us,
yes,
you can catch our other sponsors. And this will be posted on Monday on iHeartRadio for those of you that
Once again, before we get started, very important to go over those COVID numbers we've had. Our current death rate has gone up to 2.9 million cases last week, and our death rate has gone up to 960,000. And that's our death rate has gone up to 960,000. And the one I like to look at is the recovery. We're at 1.1 million. That's half. We could keep the new cases. So 1.1 million. That's half. United States.
recovery
a fair
rate
week.
Going up.
We went up to 7.2 million cases.
United States,
it's up about 300,000.
We went up to 7.2 million
cases. 208,000.
It's up about 300,000.
It's only gone up about 5,000.
208,000.
And our recoveries,
it's only gone up
4.4 million.
We've gone up 200,000.
And our recoveries,
and locally here in the state of Nevada,
4.4 million. We've gone up 200,000.
78,000.
And locally here in the state of Nevada,
78,000 plus cases.
78,000 plus cases
from last week,
which is up almost.
Just be aware of that we've got some
1,000 from last week
have gone up by
50. That we've got some.
We're up at 1582,
and our recoveries are
94% now.
We're up at
almost 94%.
So we're doing really good there.
That came up 4%
from last week. Almost 94%.
And sounds like we got a call already.
It came up.
Just have to get to the call first before we get to you, Joe.
And sounds like we got a call already, but we just have to get to.
Yeah, RJ, this is Jim calling in. I believe there's a correction on.
Yeah, RJ, this is Jim calling in.
I believe there's a correction. On the channel 13, I believe that was channel 8.
Okay, that's good to know, Jim.
Channel 8 is correct.
You're always keeping it straight. That's good to know, Jim.
All right, we'll get off the air.
You're always keeping it straight.
I appreciate you flying in. We'll get off the air. But Joe, so nice to meet you, and I appreciate you flying in to share your book with us.
So, Joe, I got to read your book.
We'll get started with the book.
Excellent read. Yeah. So, Joe, I got to read your book. Excellent
what,
read.
What
made or why did you want to write this book?
The primary reason I wanted to write this is after 40 years of silence, I began talking about my experience with helping one another veteran. I thought there was a possibility, that we might be able to help one another. I simply want to share my experience and not anybody that's looking to treat anybody. I simply want to share my experience and strength and hope. 20 to 22 servicemen and women kill themselves every single day. Between the ages of 15 and 24 is the second leading cause of death in our young people. And we need to do something about it. And I believe my experiences could help people with that.
Yeah, there was a line in your book that I could really identify with is that hope gives some clarity in our lives and some light and some clarity takes the doom and gloom of fear out of it. So I really like that line. Doom and gloom of fear out of it. So I really like that line.
Joe, he signed his book off. It says JF Whitaker on the front. But Joe, he signed his book off. It says JF Whitaker on the front.
GPJ.
He goes by Joe.
You're going to have to read the book, but there's another nickname in there called GPJ.
And you're going to have to read the book to find that one.
And we will not mention the C word.
Yes.
Okay.
If you remember that from the book.
So I want to ask you, read that. And all that you have had to deal with, have you had any
Bombers that were bombing Hanoi happened, but we were analyzing why that was happening. And 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 why that was happening with a significant portion of the left side being removed. There is no scientific link between skin cancer and exposure to Agent Orange.
But again, the VA is taking wonderful care of me.
We were waiting on the repair to whatever it was we were doing. Tarmac, I took a flight to come in to take off from the upper part of our body, showing signs of skin cancer. I am still showing signs of skin cancer. I had a terrible spot on my torso, left a huge scar.
When people would say, were you shot?
And I thought that would be a better story.
That was a better story than, no, I had skin cancer, but I have received excellent care from the VA.
The VA does have some glitches over the years and still get it, so I'm very happy with VA.
We always mention this to all the veterans in there. There are workarounds, but to get what you need from VA and part of those workarounds, looking up through either the VA work site, part of those workarounds is doing website, are looking up to either the VA work site, VA the waiting area is probably the best classroom in their VA. Is at the VA for learning
the waiting
about the VA.
Area is
you hear all
probably
the veterans
the
talking about
what
they did this, they didn't do
VA
this
for learning about,
and
the
you
VA.
Can get this done.
You hear
if
all
you
the
do
veterans
this.
Talking about what
and
they did this.
It's very educational, and
you can get this done if you do this.
Clinicians that are at the VA. To take off their badge, go sit down in that waiting area, sit, and you would be surprised at the things you may learn about the VA that you did not even know.
Yes. Yeah, vets aren't quiet, that's for sure. They know. They want to let you know the ins and outs, and anytime they can help, they're always willing. So.
And also state benefits. I'm going to mention that real quick because Nevada has some really good state benefits. The one that I take advantage of is being a 100% disabled veteran. I do not have to put money in a parking meter, pay a parking lot, or what else? The parking lots, I guess, anything that's operated by the city, county, or state, I get in free with my 100% right. disabled veteran plate. So, and California, I'm sure, has some pretty good benefits, too. I know hunting and fishing licenses, I don't know if you're into that, but I believe those are free to 100% disabled vets. And there's just a whole mass of benefits out there in your state, and I encourage you to go to your state website for your veterans office and see what they are. Some can really be beneficial. Now, Joe, you've been in the Navy 6 years, and you've been to Vietnam, and I'm going to say this now. It's really a miracle that you've come back from Vietnam because a lot of people did not. And after you describe some of your duties and that and some of the places that you flew, it's amazing that you're here.
I'm kind of grateful that I'm here.
Yeah. God has a way.
There were 55,000 men that did not come home from Vietnam, and many, many more who were injured, either physically or mentally, that some that have still not returned. So yeah. It's very sad.
We still have some that may still be alive over there that are, who knows, are they prisoners or have they assimilated and just kind of got brainwashed and left there. This is National Suicide Prevention Month, and if they get your book, The Day Before I Died, you had your own little episode with suicide. And as you said, you not got no help from the VA for any type of therapy in that, but you were taking one of the longer-term suicides that there would be, and I call that DBA, death by alcohol. And if you look at that, it kind of sounds like one of the open verdict type things where you don't know the true cause of death. He died alcoholism. Well, maybe they don't know that you were actually trying to kill yourself. So that's just something to think about. And did you feel like you were on that downward spiral toward killing yourself? Or what was the moment that the light turned on and said, I got to quit doing this before I die?
Okay, that's a two-part question. So let's start with the first part, and that is, yes, I was on the downward spiral. Yes, it was the plan. It was no accident that I was drinking myself to death. From 1971 to 1977, every single day I wanted to die. I would go to bed every single night and say, I hope I don't wake up to see the dawn of the next day. I did not want to do that. I was faced with too many difficulties, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. I was completely bankrupt. I did not want to face the next day because I didn't have the resources and I didn't know how to do it. And I did not know to even connect with VA to get that kind of help back then. So we're not going to blame anybody. It's my problem, my fault, and I needed to do something about it. So, but yes, I was on the path for death by alcohol.
Well, it's interesting. There's a lot of veterans out there. They get out of service and they have no clue about how to connect to the VA. And if you're on that day where you're going to separate, you need to look into getting VA benefits. One of the places you can look here is through the Veterans Transition Resource Center. You can give us a call at 702-954-6300. Press option 3 will get you connected to a veteran advocate that's certified by the state of Nevada, and he will call and set up either a online appointment where you can see him visually or a phone appointment. And hopefully in the future here, as the governor starts to lift some of the restriction, the face-to-face appointment, and you can actually come into our office. However, if you want to join today's conversation, you can give us a call at 702-257-5396 and outside the Las Vegas area, toll free
800-414-1056.
And even if you're not connected to the VA formally, or you don't think you have VA benefits and you are suicidal, please call them. They will do an initial assessment, an initial treatment to help you get through that crisis and that dark place. And that was my problem. I had no way out of the darkness. I didn't know how to get out. And they will help. So do not hesitate to call.
One of the interesting things that's happened since Vietnam, we're now at war in Afghanistan. And it's a whole different type warfare. And you can describe maybe some of the warfare that was used over there. You said you like to sit with your back toward a wall in case anybody throws a grenade in. But there are things that happened in Vietnam that were just common practice. And if you share some of those, I'll share some of what it's like to fight in Afghanistan today.
All right. Warfare is warfare. I don't know there's a lot of difference between Vietnam and Afghanistan as far as our mental response to it. But in Vietnam, it was commonplace for people to throw grenades into passing buses, into restaurants, into any place where there were American soldiers. So when we were going into town, and we were initially allowed to go into town when I first got into Vietnam, later that was restricted because of the damage that was being done to the troops. But I would go into a restaurant and we would always sit with our backs to the wall facing the door, and we had our exit strategy planned. We knew exactly how we were getting out of there if something should happen. And unfortunately, you couldn't tell whether it was men, women, or children who were throwing the grenades in. They were all fairly small stature, and so it was very, very difficult to know who the enemy was. So it was a difficult for us to determine that. And so I would always sit. And 40 years later, after coming home, I'm still sitting with my back to the wall.
Well, there's a wall behind you today. So
thank you very, very much for that. No, it's not quite as bad as it was when I first came home. But and if you want, I'll tell you the story. That's what prompted the book to get started anyway, or for me to start talking about my experiences. But we had those kind of experiences. And we didn't have the sophistication of the weaponry that you have in Afghanistan. So we had like rockets that were not electronically guided. They were guided by humans. So my first night in Vietnam, I'm on duty at the duty office, and all of a sudden the rocket started going off, and I had no idea what to do. The man that was training me and going off duty shortly said, "Come here, watch." And we watched, and the rockets would move down the road almost in a very, very precise pattern toward the runway. And he said, "Let's go." And we went behind the building, and we looked behind the building, and every time a rocket would go off, a head would pop up out of the ground and look at where the rocket hit, and then give guidance back to the rocket launcher, saying, "Okay, 50 feet to the north, 10 feet to the west," whatever. Anyway, it was guided by humans, and they would tunnel into the base, tunnel under the base, come up inside of the base and watch what was going on, and then provide instructions. So wasn't quite as sophisticated, but it was effective. And
well, it hasn't really changed much in Afghanistan today, because just like Vietnam, you don't know who your enemy is. You take the women over there, for example, maybe covered from head to toe, And it may not be a woman underneath that that's covered from head to toe. You don't know if there's somebody there with an AK underneath there, or they could be a human bomb underneath there. You don't know that, and your head is constantly on a swivel. And I think that makes us super vigilant, just like you were when you came back from Vietnam. Most of the veterans that come back from Afghanistan, super vigilant for the same reasons. You don't know who to trust. You don't know who the enemy is. And you want to stay alive, so you're constantly looking around. And one of the things that's a little bit different is because the culture in Southwest Asia instead of Southeast Asia is there are a lot of Muslim people there, and their religion is such that if you look incorrectly at a person's wife, it's okay for them to take you out in the street and beat you down to the ground, and that's a common practice over there. So you just don't look. And if you do, you take that chance. But that's a little bit different than what you had. Of course, we're in an urban environment versus a jungle environment. So a little bit of an update on what it's like to come back. And of course, you said when you came back, you didn't have any mental health help from the VA. And I think stigma had a lot to do with that. Back then, did you feel like stigma was holding you back on any treatment from being helpful toward your drinking or toward what you felt about when you came back from the war?
Yes, and I often say I came back, I wanted to be your hero. I wanted to be your hero, but how could I be your hero when I was hypervigilant, unable to open the door and go out for groceries, waking up every single night, going through the house, making sure the doors were locked? That doesn't sound like a hero to me, so it felt weak. So I did not want to show weakness by seeking help, and so I did not.
Okay. Yeah. Plus, in Vietnam, when we got out of the service, it wasn't well thought of war. We were really persecuted, baby killers, warmongers, especially by the hippies. You know, they were into peace and love. And
there's nothing wrong with that.
No, not at all. But, you know, who's going to protect you while you're having peace and love? Well, it's the baby killers and the warmongers.
Speaking of peace and love, I think we need to look at that toward today, because we're not experiencing a lot of peace and love out there right now.
And
I go back and I say, I don't care what color you are, what religion, whatever, anything about you. When you're doing stuff that's wrong, that's inhumane to other people, you need to pay the dues for doing that. In other words, if you do something wrong, then you need to go to jail or get fined or whatever it is that you've done to harm another human being. There seems to be a lack of mutual respect out there right now. And I wish the hippies were back. Maybe we could spread some peace and love.
Yes.
But let's go back to that point. We weren't even comfortable wearing our uniforms in public when we came home.
Yeah.
And so how would you expect me to stand up and say, I need help? Okay. I need help because of the Vietnam experience. I was trying to downplay that I was even there so you wouldn't protest against me, so that you wouldn't. Actually, we were spit upon in many occasions. And so I kind of hid in the shadows. I can't speak for everybody, but I kind of retreated because I didn't want to bring that extra attention to myself.
Yeah, I never felt that way myself. I came back from Japan in 1986, and that's the only time I ever felt kind of out of place, because I was getting a lot of these strange looks at the airport, and we had been out of Vietnam for 11 years already. And I'm like, I didn't know that was still there, but it's there. And, of course, the stigma today still exists if you have any mental health issues, basically from being in combat or experiencing combat. We have the help there, but put it this way, it's not always looked upon by your peers and by your people above you as being something that's really healthy for you. For example, in today's world, we have something called two-man control policy, and that's for anybody that deals with those assets, particularly nuclear assets, has to be under two-man control. We have what we call the Personal Reliability Program, PRP. And if you have any type of mental health issue, guess what? Your PRP goes out the window. You can no longer handle two-man control material. And that means a lot of times that you can no longer work in that job. So I don't know if that was a fear that you had when you were doing your duties over there. But once again, you were an aviation officer resource. You were, I guess, like electronics warfare.
Electronic reconnaissance.
And did you have any of that feeling that if you went and talked to anybody and it got back to your peers or to your boss, that they would come down on you and say, can't bring that up, don't do that?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And it was frowned upon to look weak or be weak in whoever eyes that was. But, we need to change that stigma. It actually takes strength to reach out for help. It takes strength to say, I have been fundamentally altered by the experiences that I saw in the war zone, whatever war zone it might be. And one of the most awakening moments for me when I came home was I knew that I had fundamentally altered. I knew that I was fundamentally changed. Everything about me was different. Earlier, before we got on the program, I said I would come home and look at pictures of myself, and I didn't even recognize myself. I didn't even recognize that person. So fundamentally altered. And the rest of the world back here did not change. And so the distance between me and them got farther and farther and farther apart. Okay? And the stronger position would have been to say, help me close that gap. Help me recognize what those changes are. How do I manage those changes, and how do I move on in life as a productive member of society?
Yeah, I'm going to take a giant step backwards now and take you back to your childhood, because you grew up in a very large family.
Yes. Yes, I had six brothers and three sisters.
In a two-room house, right?
No, I'm just kidding.
But you did have an occasion when you all had to get up and leave the house in the middle of the night.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. The fire. You're talking about the fire.
I'm talking about the fire.
Yes, yes. We lived in a very old brick farmhouse outside Philadelphia, and it was in rural Pennsylvania. So there was like one house across the street, a few hundred feet down the road a little bit, not far, and not much else. And we were in a blizzard, and the house caught fire. We were awakened with the house filled with gray smoke, and Dad was trying to figure out what was going on. He finally said, okay, evacuate now. We have to get out. It's too dangerous. So we packed up the 10 kids. There were 10 by that point, and marched across the street to this neighbor's house, and they were practically strangers. We did not know them. They were of the Mennonite religion in the Pennsylvania area, and they were very quiet and to themselves, so we did not know them. And so here we are in the 2 o'clock in the morning. I don't know what time it was, but very early in the morning, pounding on their door saying, give us some help. Open the door and let 12 people into your house. It was a unique situation.
Well, it seems like the pendulum has swung completely the other way today, where people aren't that helpful for people they don't know. And I think we need to get to that point where you could go knock on a stranger's door, and if you need help, they'll provide help to you. That's the kind of society I would like to live in, and I think that's the society that everybody else wants to live in. And I don't care whose lives matter, everybody's lives matter, and that's where we should be going. We should be going in that direction.
Well, these people opened their door to us and could not have made us feel more welcome or more at home. And in the book, I talk about returning to a time when we had a community. We had a community of largely extended family that were there to help each other, to be eyes for each other, to support each other in difficult times. And, you know, we moved away. The baby boomers started moving away for the next big job, the next big opportunity. And, you know, maybe it's time to go back, because the police force by itself, no movement by itself is going to change the world that we live in. But we as individuals, we as a community can change our world if we start looking out for one another and taking care of one another.
Well, back then you didn't need as big of a police force, because everybody respected each other. Nobody really intentionally broke the law unless they were a hardcore criminal.
We left our doors unlocked. We reached out to each other. There was no fear back then. Now there's fear. I'll tell you, the day we started locking our doors was the day John F. Kennedy was assassinated. Mm-hmm. We started thinking the world was starting to become unsafe, and it has gotten progressively worse since that time. I wish we could go back to the times when we can leave our doors unlocked. And when neighbors moved into the neighborhood, we bought them casseroles and said welcome. And we knew who our neighbors were. And we knew who was occupying the houses that our children passed on the way to school. And we could keep them safe. And if there was some inappropriate activity, we would report it and nip it in the bud.
And I think that's why people should read your book, to learn about that experience and see the direction that we should be going today. And it just so happens we've got a couple books that you donated to us that we would like to give away on the air. And if you call into the station, the first two callers will get the book, and we will either mail it to you or come out and hand it to you. And Joe has gracefully signed it off in the front. Give us a call at the station, 702-257-5396. And if you live outside the Las Vegas area, if you still want to call in and try to get that book, give us a call toll-free at
800-414-1056.
I'm glad you know that number.
I got it down now.
Okay.
So, Joe, on your book, how long did it take you to write your book?
Oh, wow. 4 years. It took 4 years. I remember promising somebody it would be done in less than two. But I had a tragedy in my life during the time I was writing it. My oldest daughter passed away, and I lost a year in the writing process. I could not pick up the pen and start writing again until I dealt with the death of my daughter, and that took some time. It was very tragic.
That's a grieving period, and, you know, I'm glad you brought that up, because when people grieve, they grieve differently, and sometimes it takes a long time, sometimes it's short. You just got to go through it. It's life.
Yes. Yes, it is. Unfortunately, it is life. And it did take me a while. When she passed away, she had an accident. And when she passed away, she did not immediately die. So we had to take her off life support. And I was standing by her bedside when we did that. And as they took her off the life support, her body started moving or twitching, and to me that was signs of hope, and my heart filled with hope. And then I heard some heavy gasping. I called it breathing, and I was trying to will her to breathe, and I was trying to help her breathe, and I was actually breathing for her. And then she stopped breathing, and I stopped breathing. I don't know how long it was, but a few seconds I stopped breathing, and I actually had the thought I wanted to go in the grave with her. It was that tragic to me and that big of a loss to me that I just thought, I don't know if I'll survive this. But I had to come to the realization that it was my daughter that died and not me, and that I still had work to do, and I was here for a reason, and I have other children, and I have grandchildren, and I have great-grandchildren, and I had to move on beyond that. It took time, but I did.
Do they have as big a family as yours with 10 children?
My Who?
Your children.
Oh, no.
They kept us
No.
We're not as crazy, I guess.
Yeah, no. My children can barely handle my family, so because we're very loud, and we have family reunions all the time, and everybody talks at the same time, so we're very, very loud and demand much of each other, which is wonderful. I think it's wonderful. I'm not complaining. So now my oldest daughter, who's passed, had three children. My second daughter has one child, and my son, who's the youngest, has three children.
You know, it's funny you mention that, because I worked with a lady that had eight children, and what she told me was this: we didn't have a TV.
So you think that's what caused it?
It was either that or the water. I can't figure that out yet.
I tell people I come from a family of 10, and they say, "Oh, Catholic?"
Yes. Definitely.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, as a reminder, our Veterans Office, our State Veterans Office, is closed at this time. But if you still need help with a Veterans Advocate or a Veterans Service Officer, you can give them a call at 702-830-2000. Did I get that right? Yeah, 830-2000. And they will... You leave a message, they will call you back and set up an appointment for you to either visit them online, face-to-face online, or they will do it over the phone. It's very important that you apply for these benefits. once you're out of service, you don't have to worry about the stigma that's in the military anymore. And when you go to the VA, there's a lot of other people like you that are there that are suffering from the same things. As I said, it's so important to sit down in that waiting area and just listen. You will learn so much. It's unbelievable how much you will learn.
Yeah, they'll tell you. They like to talk. Veterans do like to talk. But the biggest thing is it's the old concept, we never leave a brother behind. So they want to keep you informed to new things or what they know, you know, which is great because you will learn a lot. Just open your eyes and ears.
Okay. And I'm just, for our board operator at the station, I just want to say, if you'll make note of those names and addresses and possibly phone numbers, we'll get to that after the show, and then we'll make sure those books get delivered.
So how long ago did you finish the book?
The book was finished in November of 2019.
Oh, just before COVID hit.
Yes. Yes.
A COVID book.
No, it's not a COVID book. But it was finished around November of 2019 and actually published December 19th of 2019. It hit the bookshelves at that time. And yes.
Already have a publisher or did you?
Yes. Okay. It was all done through the publisher at that time, Page Publishing. It was done, like I say, December 19th, 2019. It was on the bookshelves. We had a San Diego book launch in January and a Palm Springs book launch early January as well, like the 6th and the 11th on both of those. And sales were going great and then COVID hit. So.
Yes.
Oh, that's so, put a damper on a lot of things. And
so if I was to write a book, should I go find a publisher before I write it or write it and then take it to a publisher?
You should write it and then take it to a publisher. A publisher is not going to look at you until they see a manuscript, unless you've written many before.
Okay, yes.
If they know you, you have a reputation, that may be different. But if you're unknown, the way you go about it is you send them the manuscript and they look at it and say, yes, I'd like to represent you.
And okay. It's really strange. I think sending it electronically is probably the best way because a friend of mine published a book and it had to be in a certain type it had to be a certain size type that the manuscript had to be in before he sent it in them, before they would even consider looking at it.
And many people seek an agent before they seek a publisher. They'll go to an agent and then the agent will find a publisher. And the agent is even more demanding than that. They will ask for just the first 50 pages or 50 words, you know, whatever, and in such and such a format, and this is how you put it in an email, and then they will read it, and then they will find you a publisher. I used a cross between self-publishing and a traditional publishing.
Okay.
So well, you have a very good agent, though, because he's been the one that approached us about having you on the show, and he's been super helpful in providing us the books to give out to the audience and just the communication back and forth. It's really been great.
Good. I appreciate that. That's a company called Avenir Thinking out of San Diego, California, and my account manager's name is James. So, okay. Yes, he's been very good.
Excellent. So, you had a little glitch and you had to stop for a year, and so it took 4 years to get it completely down. Were you happy with it when you completed it?
I was happy it was done because it was a lot of work and it was very painful to write, particularly when I had to write about my daughter, but even my own personal memories, it was very, very difficult. I would say the predominant emotion was fear when it came out. That's very personal. It's very personal, and it's me opening up for the first time after 50 years from Vietnam. Most people, including my family, did not know the details that were contained in this book. They were surprised. In November, I did a book reading for them in Milwaukee, a number of my brothers and sisters, and they were very, very surprised at the content of the book. Some emotionally upset by it.
Yes, we have a way of hiding things, don't we? Keeping things cloaked away and not out there for everybody, so your family didn't even know. So,
no. And that's true of a lot of vets, because you would not believe the number of widows and widowers that come in here,
oh, and yes.
That veteran spouse that has passed away, didn't say a word to them about anything that was available to them should they die. And we probably handled 30 to 40 widows in here during 1 month, during one of the peak months that we've had the center open. And they were all, you know, well, aren't we supposed to, isn't the VA supposed to pay for the burial? Isn't the VA supposed to do this? We get all these questions asked, and believe it or not, it's the veteran who did not say a word. And I encourage, if you're not the veteran and you're either their caregiver or you're the spouse, you need
or a child,
you need to get in contact with us and learn about those benefits. You can give us a call at the center at 702-954-6300. You can talk to Jim or myself or a veteran advocate. I am Jim is option one, I am option two, and the veteran advocate is option three.
Yeah, I have a godson that's like 12 or 14 now. And there's times, just like in your book, when you were, your granddaughter said something to you at dinner one night, you know, why do you always sit with your back to the wall? Are you privileged or something? Everybody, you have to have your audience. And you told her the truth, and it like you said, it stunned her, it shocked her, and then it opened up the avenues for some deep insight and revealing exactly some of the memories and some of the problems.
And that occurred in 2012, so that'll tell you how long after Vietnam that was.
Yeah.
And as long as you brought it up, let's just mention, you know, we talk about how war or Vietnam or Afghanistan affects the veteran or the military personnel. How about the families? Let's not forget the families. In Vietnam, we had a plane crash in Da Nang that killed 22 people. And I was supporting the wife of one of the pilots that was killed, and she had two young boys, 4 to 6 years, 4 and 6, or somewhere in that neighborhood. I don't remember the exact age, but I was helping them, and one day I'm sitting in the living room, and the oldest, the six-year-old, comes over and puts his hand on my knee and looks at me and says, you know, my daddy's dead. And I said, yes, I know. And I didn't realize his mother had told him, but he said, yeah. I said, yes, I know. And he looks me in the eye and he says, are you going to be my daddy now? And it broke my heart. I can't tell you how painful that was. But the lives of that woman, that wife, that mother, the lives of those two children have been irrevocably changed from that moment on. They will not be the same people they were before that. And I don't know that we acknowledge that. That's the cost of war as well.
Yes.
And one of the interesting things that I've experienced in my life is we had a crash, and we all were invited over to the widow's house. And when we saw her compared to when they first arrived at our base, she looked like she had aged about 30 years. That's the impact on your health and your body. She looked 30 years older than what she was.
Hmm. Yep, it's we only look at us and we don't look at anything else. It's all about me, you know. And what we should be looking at is what we do here. It's veterans. We're here for the families, not just the veterans. So we have to deal with the widows and the children that the vets leave behind. And like you said, so many of them don't even have a clue what their fathers or uncles or anybody went through. You know, and I brought up my godson. He's 14, and then, you know, he'll ask me, what did you do? You know, and I get to relay stories. And you know what's really great is he sits and listens to them all. I mean, and the bond and the closeness that we have, you know, he's like my grandchild, really. I don't have any children. I've never had any, so I've never experienced that. But I have a godson that's like a grandchild to me.
People want to hear our stories. People want to be there for us.
Yeah.
And it's in our head that we can't tell them, that for some reason it'll be wrong or harmful or hurtful to tell them. And as we talk about the cost of war with the veterans and the families of veterans, you know, that's why I advocate for a very, very strong military presence, current state-of-the-art military presence, only as a deterrent, so you don't mess with the U.S. I want everybody to know you don't mess with the U.S., so I want a very, very strong military presence. But then I want diplomacy. At all costs, we must use diplomacy and avoid war. The cost is far too high.
Yes. War doesn't pay anybody anything. It's egotistical people that want to rule, you know, and that's about it. And the loss of lives and money and relationships and everything is just astronomical. It's just... it's not a price nobody wants to pay, you know.
And it's interesting we talk about this, and not to make it comical, but if you ever listen to George Carlin talk about war, he says this is the way wars start. My God is better than your God. And they'll say, no, no, my God is better than your God. And before you know it, this escalates back and forth, and all of a sudden they're fighting each other because one's God is better than the other God. But is it really?
No, not at all. And God teaches love, not war.
Yeah. Coming up here today, what was your thought of coming and getting interviewed on the air? We want to promote your book because we feel it has a message that we all should have, but I'm sure there's probably been a thousand things going through your mind. What are they going to ask me? What are we going to talk about? Could you share some of that with us? How was that plane ride coming up here?
You don't know if your experiences, your thoughts, your actions are unique or not. Since you didn't share them, you didn't talk about them, you have no idea if anybody else feels the same way or if you're just a complete whack job. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes. So Joe, like I told you when I was talking with you earlier today, I could identify with a lot of things in your book. And whenever you're reading a book, if you can identify with it, then the camaraderie of that identification makes you read more and absorb more and better understand who the author is. And, you know, by you sharing today, now we have a camaraderie and a bond besides just being veterans. We also have some background issues that are the same. And I can relate to a lot of the things that you talked about.
And you are welcome to come back and visit the VTRC family anytime you want.
Yes, please.
I would love
come
to do
see
that.
Us.
I would love to do that. And, you know, I wrote the book with a focus on suicide and an attempt to help other people. But many different people are getting many different things out of the book. For instance, one very good friend of mine over 40 years said, I thought I knew you. I didn't think I'd enjoy the book. But when I read it, it helped me understand my brother a little bit better, who went to Vietnam and is still silent.
Mm-hmm.
And so there were different things that people got out of there. The death of my daughter, how to deal with losing a child. Some people have gotten a little bit from that. Bullying, you name it. So it has a bunch of different things on it. And today I'm very happy that I finished it. And I don't feel like a complete whack job. I feel like other people are relating, and I'm very pleased with that.
Last question I have for you is, how did you come up with the title? The Day Before I Died.
Wow. Okay. My avenue out of the darkness was through a 12-step program. I was drinking every single day to stem off the demons, if you will, keep the demons away, to not commit suicide, even though that was a slow version of suicide, as we talked about earlier. And so I was introduced to a 12-step program that helped me not only stop drinking, but find a way to live my life, a design for living my life that would help me for years to come. And I say that I found that program the day before I died, and that's where the title comes from.
Okay, that's excellent.
Okay, one of the interesting things is we talk about suicide and taking life in it. There's a lot of veterans out there today that are on that edge and trying to get into a program or whatever, but many of the veterans that do get treatment go to the VA, and the VA packs them full of what we call VA candy, or these different types of pills, which if you mix alcohol with them, you are bound to talk about being a whack job. You are bound to be a whack job after that, because these drugs do not mix well with alcohol. And I know there's veterans out there that still take these drugs and still drink, and for your caregivers and your spouses and everybody else around them, please try to discourage it from them, because if you've seen somebody that has drank alcohol and has taken their medications and seen what it has done to them,
it will be an eye opener for you, and you shouldn't have to experience that eye opener. You should be able to get those people right before they go through that crazy period. And of course, if they drink too much along with these medications, that's it. End of story.
Yep.
Yes.
And it's too crazy. And it happens every day. Happens every day. And there are ways around that. You know, there's help out there. If you need help, give us a call. Local. The 702-257-5396.
That's on the air.
That's on the air. The VTRC is 702-954-6300. Or if you want to not call anybody, but get on the computer, and it's www.vtrc.us.
Okay, once again, it's Suicide Prevention Month.
Right.
And if you want some help, it is only a phone call away. 800-273-8255.
Yes.
If you are a veteran or calling about a veteran, press option 1. That way you will get a hold of somebody that talks like we talk, because veterans tend to use terms that other people just don't have a clue what they're talking about. So that option 1 is very important. Anything that you'd like to add, because we're running out of time, and if anybody has a last minute call they want to get into us, 702-257-5396 or
800-414-1056.
And anything, last final moment?
I got a final thing I'd like to say, and that is that suicide is a permanent solution to a temporary problem. Suicide is a permanent solution to a temporary problem. What people won't believe about that statement is that my problem is temporary. I thought it was permanent. I thought I'd be miserable for the rest of my life. No, it is a temporary problem. There are solutions. Seek help. We are here for you.
Okay. That's it.
One thing about suicide, just to mention, suicide is about two things. That's loss and pain. And dealing with that pain is to die. That's what suicide equals. But in dealing with loss and pain, what we teach in all the suicide prevention classes that we teach is that there's a third option between living and dying. There's a third option, and that is just holding off when you can look at things more sensibly, make more sense out of it. And as you said, it's a permanent solution to a temporary problem. So that's why we promote that in the classes. And before we go, I got to mention the retronormal, because it's very important right now. We want to get these COVID cases knocked down. That's our two-minute warning. Retronormal, if you cough or sneeze, catch it. Wash your hands frequently. Avoid touching your face. And if you're sick, by all means,
stay home.
You got it. Hope you join us next week. We've got a kind of a potpourri next week with a lot of different things going on. Have a safe week. We'll see you then.
Yep. God bless. Thanks, Joe.